praise God.
Yes. Amen.
Because without God, we are nothing.
Amen.
Amen. And giving honor to Him where honor is due.
Yes.
It is a blessing once again to be in the house of the Lord.
Yes, sir.
Every one of us could have been anywhere else, but we decided to come into the house and praise the Lord.
Yes.
When I look around in this sanctuary, we realize that God has been mighty, mighty, mighty good. When I look at the Hartgrove family, I know they got to be ecstatic that their mother, grandmother, and great-grandmother is living to see 90 years. And with that 90 years, I'm sure that Mother Hartgrove, along with all of our other seasoned saints that are 90 and older, they will tell you that there are some survival skills they can give a testimony about. They will tell you that it was only the mercy and grace of God that have gotten them to this point. But even for those that are of younger years, we know that if it wasn't for the Lord on our side, where would we be? And it's a blessing too with the fat cats being with us, because we did a survey downstairs to find out which one of our ministerial staff was a motorcycle rider. And unfortunately, not one. But fortunately, we still are alive. And it is good. I want to commend Reverend Hart this morning with the worship leader in reference to just acknowledging God and inviting Him into the house of the Lord.
Right.
But even with the voices of deliverance and those that stood down the floor welcoming the Lord in, it's a blessing.
Yeah.
I don't know what you come to do today, but I come to praise the Lord.
Amen.
I don't know what you expect to hear, but once again, I come to praise the Lord.
Amen.
There's a story I want to share with you this morning. And this story is about Stop the Thief. Have you ever had a thief in your presence?
Yes.
That was so quickly said. But I want to tell you about this seasoned saint. And we're going to call this seasoned saint today Mother Hartgrove. Mother Hartgrove was coming home, and she had a great time with all of her brothers and sisters and enjoyed her time with her family, and she walked into her house, and there he was, a thief. And she called out to him as soon as she saw him. She said, Acts 38. And Acts 38 tells you to repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ so that your sins may be forgiven. That's paraphrasing that particular act, and it tells you the burglar stopped right in his tracks.
Well,
he never moved until the police officer had arrived. And he asked, the policeman said, why did you stop in your tracks? He said, the only thing that Mother Hartgrove did was that she called a scripture, Acts 2, verse 38. He said, I thought she said I had an X at 2:38. So he said, I stopped in the midst of what I was doing. But I just let you know, when God is on your side, that person that's up against you, he will hear something that God needs for he or she to hear. But God is on your side. We're not going to prolong the time. I'm going to ask that you please stand, and we're going to go to Judges, chapter 6. That's all right. Mary had a little lamb, and so did Jesus. And that's going to be Judges chapter 6, verses 17, and then we're going to skip down to 36 through 39. Judges chapter 6, starting with verse 17. Then we'll go to 36 through 39. And it reads, and he said unto him, if now I have found grace in thy sight, then show me a sign that thou talkest with me. Then 36 through 39. And Gideon said unto God, if thou wilt have saved Israel by my hand, as thou hast said, behold, I will put a fleece, a word in the floor. And if the dew be on the fleece only, and it be dry upon all the earth beside, then shall I know that thou wilt save Israel by my hand, as thou hast said. And it was so, for he rose up early on the morrow, and thrust the fleece together, and wringed it, the dew out of the fleece, a bowl full of water. And Gideon said unto God, let not thine anger be hot against me, and I will speak but this once. Let me prove, I pray thee, but this once with the fleece, let it now be dry only upon the fleece, and upon all the ground let there be dew. And God did so that night, for it was dry upon the fleece only, and there was dew on that ground. Amen. You may be seated. And let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask for your word to be blessed at this time. We ask that every word be spoken, be given to the ear of your children. But as it goes through the ear, let it flow into the heart, and let them know it's you and you alone. I am removed at this time, God, but it's always you in the center. We give you the highest praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Judges, the 6th chapter,
yes.
Verses 17, 36 through 39. I want us to focus on the 39th verse. And it reads, and Gideon said unto God, let not thine anger be hot against me, and I will speak but this once. Let me prove, I pray thee, but this once with the fleece. Let it now be dry only upon the fleece, and upon all the ground let there be dew.
Yeah.
We're back in our third part of our series of the Mission Impossible. Fierce stumping to marching in our faith. The first series, we dealt with fear, stumping our fear. The second series, we dealt with courage. But now we find the part where we ask God for confirmation. Yeah. Have you ever asked God to show you a sign?
Yeah. Yeah.
Have you ever said, God, give me confirmation?
Yeah.
Or have you ever told someone, that's just confirmation?
Yeah.
And we leap for joy because someone else have told us what we wanted to hear.
Right.
Have we ever pondered and said, God, I need to know what decisions I have to make? Because we do come to a crossroad in life called the crossroad of a decision.
Yes, yes.
We're reading Judges about Gideon. One that would be the warrior. You know, we get caught up in the fact that Gideon started with 30,000 soldiers, and God broke them down to 20,000, and the next thing we know, they're down to 300. We get excited because of the fact, we say that's what God is showing us, that how he works. So when we face the wall of decision, or we face a wall that is a triumphant moment, we will go and say that, God, this is my Gideon moment.
Oh,
or we'll say, God, this is my Job moment.
Well, well.
But today I want you to realize it is your moment. There was only one Job.
All right.
That's right.
There was only one Gideon.
All right.
Yes, sir.
And there's only one of you.
Amen.
So we find comfort in God's word because as we travel through the word, we see that there's justice.
Yeah, well.
We see that there's hope.
Yeah. All right.
And we see that there's deliverance.
Yeah. Yeah.
But we also understand with our brother Gideon, just like with our brother Abram, coming from a family that believed in idols. How can God take someone that is not from a particular family or religious sect and make this one person become a warrior? The reason why is that God can do whatever he want to do, when he want to do it, and how he want to do it. But we realize, too, that God is the one to do the choosing. We're just the one always trying to do the picking. But if we get out of God's way and allow him to choose for us, then we will realize that God's hands in the midst of it all. But it wasn't just Gideon. Also in the question of giving signs, we had our dear brother Moses. When Moses was in the Mount of Horeb, and then before the burning bush, when he was told that he would be the one that is selected to go forth and deliver God's people, you know Moses said, "How can I speak, Lord, when I stutter? Why would they believe me out of all people? You know they banned me from the place. I'm an exile. I'm minding my own business. I've gotten used to being a shepherd. I've gotten used to this staff being in my hand. Now you want to call me for a work to be done? Have you ever been called out? And you had to step forth and you just said, God, I need confirmation. Moses was no different than us in reference to being human. In reference to question God and what he should do. But he sat right before a burning bush and a voice was speaking. What we say in today's time, that should have been enough all by itself. But even when God speaks to you, in whatever way that he does, that should be enough. But still you ask him for a sign, a confirmation. So while Moses is before that bush and he's talking with the God Almighty, God said, take that staff and lay it down. And that staff becomes a serpent. See, when God starts answering your questions and start giving you confirmation, you get scared because it's saying that Moses moved back. From the staff. And God told him to reach out again. And it became a staff once more. After that, you think we should be satisfied because God has shown himself to you. But then Moses asked, what if they don't listen, God? God said, take your hand and put it inside your bosom. He pointed out and there was leprosy. Then Moses is kind of having a freak out moment. Because his hand is a leprosy. And then God asks him to return it to his bosom. And it comes out the way it should have been in the beginning. But God reminds him, I will give and I will take away. But you thought that Moses would be satisfied. He's gotten two signs. But then he asked God again. And God said, when you get to that designated point, take that staff and stir it in the water. And watch and see it turns to blood. But when God said that I am, that I am, that's all we need. occurring.
Yeah, that's right.
We find ourselves with our children. Should I hold on to them?
Yeah.
Should I let them go? Should I let life teach them lessons?
Well.
Or should I try to teach it to them?
Yeah.
Should I join the fat cats or the big shots? Yeah. Or just should I be an honorary member and keep it safe? Boldly and humbly and say, hey God, it's me today.
Well, yeah.
that you came short. But one day you can be rest assured that he will tell that counselor, I'm going to love him anyway.
Hallelujah.
If you want confirmation from God, you got to have a dependency of God. His relationship is building. But how can you expect for God to give you so much? And you giving him so little? How can you expect for God to keep you protected on the road? You won't even call his name in the house. What is it that you're asking God for? It's about a relationship, but it's also about confirmation. You want to invest in a relationship unless you know that person's going to do you right. It's a bad thing to get a relationship and the male or female can't remember your name. Why they call you their ex's name? I can promise you God won't call you Satan. I can promise you God won't call you any other name but the name he's given you, which is my child. Ask yourself, what are you doing to have that relational bond? Mama may fail you. Daddy may too. But God will always be there for you. But you gotta want to be in a relationship. Confirmation. How many are waiting for that call to say it came through? How many are waiting for that doctor report to say what we were looking at? I don't know what happened. I'm scratching my head here. How many are waiting to be able to say, I got it? You got to have the willingness of being. We understand that we got to have a relational bond. But I want to share secrets with you. If the heart surrenders, then your ear will also render to God's word. God's word convicts us. It convicts us. No matter how much we want to say it doesn't, it does. Because if you want to do right, you want to grow right.
That's right.
You're going to read right. And you're going to invest in it right. For we have those moments who don't know how to hear God's voice. When you have those moments, just be still. And know that he is God. He will exalt amongst the heathen. And he exalts his earth. That's the God that we serve. It's in Isaiah 43 and 19. Behold, I will do a new thing. It's a spring forth. And it said that you should not even know it when it happens. God will spring forth in your life. He will make a difference if you're willing to make a difference. Confirmation. It means in knowing that it has been validated. You know how we are. We want to be validated by people. They say I'm in, I'm in. They say I'm out, I'm out. They say I'm a good person, then I'm a good person. If they say I just come a little short, then I'm a little short. But what it reminds us, we all have sinned and come short of the glory of the Lord. But God is mighty good. If we have the relational bond and the willingness to hear, then we gotta have the willingness for those who are lost to bond with God again. For them to be able to reconcile. We gotta be able to stand on God's word. What are you waiting on? What are you waiting on today? We bring down the wall by marching in our faith. We had to go through the fear moment to stop that fear. We had to have that courageous moment. Now we're at the point, should we move? How should we move? Where should we move? When should we move? But it comes with the confirmation of God. Are you doubting your relationship with Jesus Christ? It's not too late. It's not too late to let God know. I understand. Confirmation that today, God is making a difference in our lives. Confirmation to know this will fail on you. But you can call God anytime. Only thing God asks. With a phone, you can be in the bed. With a phone, you can be in the restroom. With a phone, you can be in the kitchen. With a phone, you can be in your car. With a phone, you can even be on your motorcycle, I think. But the thing is that you have this accessibility. But what happens when the battery goes hot? What happens when you're not able to get a call? I want to tell you about a phone. A phone of confirmation.